Hello, everybody. Welcome back to our podcast series on the category of ancient wisdom demystified. Today's topic is the evolution of God, period one, the early humans, from 400,000 to 40,000 years ago. So, Tata, was God like a necessity for humans from early times?
Yeah, that's a very valid question. How did at all the concept of God came into being is something that we need to examine, because I will open my explanation with a quote from H.L. Mencken. He was an American journalist, essayist, satirist, cultural critic, and scholar. And on religion, what he says is very important. Its single function is to give man access to the powers which seems to control his destiny. And its single purpose is to induce those powers to be friendly with him. Nothing else is essential. That is what Mencken says. Early hominids, 400,000 to 40,000 years before, which includes the Neanderthal, the Denisovan, and some part of the Cro-Magnon, started with simple rituals. Because we come to know from archaeological research that Neanderthals may have buried their dead, which is evidence of a use of a ritual. The use of burial ritual is thought to be the evidence of a certain type of religious activity. A social and psychological need, which was driven by evolutionary needs. We will see how it is.
Okay.
Appeal to satisfaction to a higher power for the tribe's security and for individual well-being was the purpose of any form of worship or devotion to God. Yeah.
Okay. So, Tata, what was the triggering point in the need for religion and God?
Yeah, the religious mind is one of the consequences of the brain that is large enough to formulate religious and philosophical ideas. During the human evolution, the hominid brain tripled in size, peaking at 500,000 years ago. That was the Neanderthal period. Much of the brain's expansion took place in the neocortex. Computation of complex phenomena, such as perception, thought, language, attention, episodic memory means long-term memories about your childhood and other things that happens to you, and voluntary movement. This was all the function of the neocortex. And if you look at our predecessors, the apes, the chimpanzees, the neocortex of a chimpanzee occupies hardly about 50% of the total brain. While modern human being, the neocortex occupies about 80%. Stephen Jay Gould, another great 20th century evolutionary biologist, suggests that religion may have grown out of evolutionary change, which favored larger brains as means of cementing group harmony, the cohesiveness of the savanna hunters. After that, larger brain enabled him to go into deeper reflection on the inevitability of a personal mortality. So this is the basic reason why religion as a starting point was triggered in the early hominids.
Okay. So is it then correct to assume that it was really the Homo sapiens, the earlier hunter-gatherers were conceived of a higher power?
Yeah, the hunter-gatherers had a what we called as an archaic consciousness. Archaic consciousness is one that identifies yourself not different from nature. This was John Gebser, who came up with this classification in the 20th century. Nature was their prime ally, and there was a categorizing of nature as an ally as well as a superior power. In a small tribe of 25 to 30 people, it was essential to form, also from an evolutionary trajectory, two fundamental actions that are required, both for psychological and physical well-being. Because you had a very small population, So what we needed was any activity that you do gets prioritized for kin selection. What we say is kin selection. That is your family, your brothers and sisters, and your own close-knit family, which is around you in the cave. That is reciprocal altruism is actually when somebody does something good to you, you feel obligated to do something good for them. So that is what is essential. Yeah.
Nice. So to meet these two evolutionary needs, how did the hunter-gatherers conceive like a superior power?
Yeah. Fortunately, we have some modern research in the 19th century where Albert Samuel Gadshet, a Swiss-American ethnologist, an ethnologist, a person who studies different cultures and societies. Nice. He spent a lot of time with a tribe in Oregon in USA. They were called the Klamath tribes of hunter-gatherers. They still do the hunting and gathering activity. And to a limited extent, they have moved into agrarian activity. But they continue to speak the ancient language. So, in fact, this man, Gadshet, he compiled a dictionary of their language and the English language. And what he found was there were basically five different types of classification of God or some superior power or the divine power. The first one is known as the elemental spirits. That is, you don't see the superior power anywhere else, but along with the elements that are around you, nature.
Yeah, makes sense.
Yeah. A good example is Chukchi tribe in Siberia. When there is a very cold wind, because you know Siberia is very cold, and when there is a very cold wind or a blizzard, and what they do is they go out and stand in the open, they drop their pants and show their buttocks to the wind and say, if you don't go away, I will pollute you with my smell.
Oh, damn.
So that was the type of activity which you cannot really digest from a Western or modern civilization.
Yeah.
So the second type of superior being or supernatural being were called the puppeteers. That is, nature has got certain elements which are really controlling some other elements like puppets. And so they are called the, you know, the puppeteers. Then you have a classification called the organic spirits. Birds, animals, all this seem to have some sort of a superior power. For example, the coyote, which howls in the night and there is a full moon, and you associate it with the evil spirit. If you hear that, then there is something that is going on which is evil to you. Then you have the fourth type called the ancestral spirits, where you take your ancestors to be inhabiting nature in trees, in mountains. For example, the Aboriginal tribes in Australia, they believe that the Eyre Mountain in the middle of Australia is a resident of ancestral spirits. So also, you have got quite a few tribes in North America which believe that there are sacred sites, maybe trees, caves, etc., etc., which has got ancestral spirits. Then you have the fifth type, which is the high god. And that is where man really separates from a superior being, which is outside of nature. And Charles Darwin, in his HMS Beagle, when he visited Tierra del Fuego, the tip of South America, there is a hunter-gatherer tribe there. And they told him that if we don't behave properly and we commit a crime, then God will send a very bad storm. So that was their belief. So this is the type of evolution of, you know, understanding of a superior power.
Man, crazy.
Yeah.
So, Tata,
yeah.
Is there any archaeological evidence of the stages of evolution of the concept of a higher being?
Yeah, sure. the most revealing thing is the cave art. If you go, if you go into Europe and other places, you find a lot of cave art. And cave art has got not only animals, but you got also images of a half animal, half man, which means it's an integral part of the higher power being part of you. But being a hunter-gatherer, his immediate reference was the animal. So for him, the animal was sacred. So man and animal are associated as two beings, but one. So this is a archaeological evidence, but quite a lot of archaeological evidence, because you've got some, very crude form of images which are there in the caves. So, and they have a high altar where the images are kept. So these are things which indicate that there was a feeling of religious worship based on nature and a higher God who we have to worship, who will be favoring you with his goodies.
Nice. Can we then assume that the concept of a higher power evolved with the human evolution from natural elements to a cosmic being?
From
nature all the way to something out of this world?
Yeah, sure. Because if you see what happened in man's consciousness, the human consciousness, especially as you evolved from the Neanderthal to the Homo sapiens, you started perceiving higher and more complex things. And so this led to the expansion of your understanding about your own self and your relation to nature. For example, we saw a few episodes back how mythology evolved.
Yeah.
So this is actually a capacity for man to tell stories which will reveal higher truth. So these processes started endorsing your view that you are highly connected with nature, and also what is above nature. And what was above nature, since there was a lack of science, they had to propose a system of hierarchies so that you connect up with all these hierarchies towards ultimate being. So that is what is the reason why we find that man slowly started moving from his archaic consciousness to magical consciousness, where he believed in magic, superstition. Like, I was telling about the Eskimo tribe. So they believed that superstition would definitely give them relief. Also, then from there only we came to mythological consciousness. That was the early or agrarian period. We came to mythological consciousness. We'll talk about this in the coming episodes in more details.
Yeah. So is it correct to assume that the next stage of evolution of the concept of God was during the agrarian era?
Yeah, you are very correct, because the agrarian era was a time when people had to settle down in communities and society, and there were a large group of people. So in order to, control the group, you need more order. So social order came into being. So all this led to where people had expanded their understanding of God and religion. So this we will talk about much more details in the coming episodes.
Nice.
Okay.
This is a super interesting topic today, Tata.
Good. I think we have done quite a bit today. So I just want to leave you with a particular thought. You see, today we live in an era in the scientific information age. In no way what we are trying to tell you now in the next couple of episodes trying to undo the faith that you have, because many people cannot go into this academic deep knowledge. For you, the faith is important. That is why many people today, probably about 80 to 90% of the whole population of the world, is strongly entrenched in belief. But the younger generation is asking questions, and it is very much essential that we give them the correct perspective of the evolution of God. There's nothing wrong in this understanding, because God is something which is a name that is given by us to a superior or a cosmic power. In whatever way you call it, it is up to you. But how this all started with the human consciousness evolving over a period of time is that what we are seeing in these episodes. Thank you very much, and we will see you in the next episode. Bye.
All right, see you. Bye-bye.